Roland. I'm the communications director for the Denver Office of Marijuana Policy and the Department of Excise and Licenses. And it's been an honor to throw this symposium for everyone. We're really, really excited to be able to share what we've done here. And they asked me to just do a quick presentation on my role here with the city and communications in general. And it is something that is a learning experience every single day, as you might imagine. So I like to say that despite marijuana being a drug, it is definitely rated E for everyone. And I'm not talking about usage. I'm talking about who wants to know, who has questions about it. And something that, well, first of all, let me just ask real quick. Do I have any PIOs, communications directors, marketing people in the room? Who do I have here? All right, that's great. So marijuana is a communication director's dream. Or a nightmare, it depends on how you look at it. So the reason why I say it's a dream is because your audience is absolutely huge. It's everyone. Everyone is going to take an interest in you and want to know what your organization is doing. I've never had this high of a success rate in terms of pitching stories to the media, right? And I just pick up the phone and say, hey, I got something in it, ma'am. There it goes. So that is it. That is a blessing and a curse, because there is no quiet time. There is no day that the phone doesn't ring. There are obviously lots of other jobs that the communications people in your shops and your organizations are responsible for doing, but the media will interrupt that at regular intervals and keep things from always moving smoothly. So I look at it as an opportunity, a tremendous challenge, a tremendous opportunity to talk about the good things that are happening, talk about the way the city is implementing this and interacting with our peers. So, you know, this information is everywhere, and I'll be the first to admit that we haven't done a great job of collecting it all, but it is very, very important that we kind of understand and embrace the fact that this is going to touch every aspect of your city, county, state organization. So having some sort of dedicated place to at least serve as a launching point or a portal to come in and start that process is very important. We have a lot of industry, obviously, in Denver with 1,000 licenses operating over 400 locations. So just having information available on the business licensing process is very important, as well as giving information to consumers, to visitors, and we'll sort of get into to each of these a little bit more. So I mentioned yesterday, you know, the two sort of buckets of audiences. There's internal, obviously, and external. So when I think about it, I try to sort of understand, okay, who is checking up on me? To whom are we accountable? And there's a lot of folks just within our own organization. I'm going to sort of touch on some of these individually, but obviously you've got your elected officials and your department heads, everyone that is sort of the policymakers, the decision leaders in your organization. Law enforcement and public safety officials, obviously, there has to be a ton of collaboration, of information sharing, going back and forth with them. One thing that I really enjoy about my role in the marijuana policy team is interacting with my fellow communications folks in all the city agencies that we work with. You know, each of us takes our role very seriously about protecting the city's brand, about making it sound like we know what we're doing when you're being asked the tough questions. And so each of my fellow communications people, whether it's the Department of Environmental Health or the Denver Fire Department, certainly the Denver Police Department, has a lot on the line. And they have been amazingly forthcoming with the information. They've been very willing to hand those stories off to me to manage. And again, blessing and a curse. So I guess the point for all of that is that as the single point of contact for marijuana issues in the city, our office has to have those relationships with the people who are actually seeing the issues on the ground and gathering that information, gathering that data, and then working back with them once they provided us that information to say, does this capture it correctly? Is this the sort of message that needs to be portrayed? What's going to change here when there's a follow-up on this next week? Because that will happen. I also touched on briefly yesterday that sort of trusted advisors and team members, those people are absolutely critical to the communications process. They're the ones that are going to keep you one step ahead of the next nightmare story. So I mentioned City Council. This is just a quick playbook, if you will, of ways to communicate about the changes that we're seeing and the policy evolutions that we're responsible for. So when we put together something like an ordinance to limit non-licensed grows to 36 plants in a particular zone lot, or when we when we run really any ordinance through City Council, there's a kind of playbook to follow. And a lot of that is upfront one-on-one meetings with City Council people. And again, this is not something your communications person probably should do. He's not that smart. So you leave that up to the policymakers and the people who are really the experts on this. But this is all part of a team effort to communicate what's about to happen and what we're hoping to see. So fact sheets, obviously very important talking points, FAQs, giving council members who will be lobbied very, very hard on the other side of what you're trying to push through. Giving them the answers to those questions ahead of time is absolutely critical. When the ordinance is filed, obviously there is a lot of other stakeholders involved with the process that need to be notified. They all should get those fact sheets and the draft bill language when that ordinance is filed, so that they have ample time to digest it and communicate back to council through the public process. There's obviously a media outreach piece of this, and you know, I think what is particularly helpful is having those relationships. I failed to introduce Ricardo earlier. He's going to speak with us, but Ricardo Baca from the Denver Post is here. He's one of the many people who are doing a great job covering this new world, and the fact that he and I can chat about the evolutions of policy and process is really invaluable to the city and our process for moving things forward. The biggest thing I'd say about anything, whether you're dealing with council or any group of stakeholders, is to illustrate the issue. So in the non-licensed grows example, you know, a lot of the lobbying we heard on the other side was like, look, this is just caregivers. You know, we're just providing providing medicine. You know, I'm just growing, you know, maybe 10, 12, excuse me, you know, maybe 100 plants or so for some friends. Or this is my sister and those are her plants and that's my sister's friend's plants. And that there was an element of truth to that, don't get me wrong, but there was also all these other issues that we were trying to solve for. Many of those were massive production scale illegal grows, as you can see pictured, a lot of weaponry, and this is only a taste of the photos that are being displayed next door, but those types of images were really invaluable for council to begin to kind of grasp the issue and understand that we weren't going after caregivers, we're going after criminals, unsafe conditions in these buildings, really health and safety hazards in our city. Not surprisingly, these pictures ended up in the Denver Post after that committee hearing. They ended up on local news that night, and again, it was just invaluable in terms of telling our story. So external communications, again, quickly touching on all these people that we're accountable to. Obviously, the residents and neighborhood groups, the people that, if any of you saw Aaron's presentation last session, you know, I'm in the same boat. Someone can just pick up the call or pick up the phone and give me a call and ask any question about what we're up to. Consumers, always, especially with the pesticide issue, I think we found a very important group to keep apprised of movements. The industry, which I'll get into more, obviously, is one of our biggest I guess most frequent communications audiences, other governments, and all of those sort of roll up into the working group process. I think you heard from Lewis this morning with the MED. They've done a great job with their working group structure as they go through rulemaking. And that's something that we began this year as we're looking at some ordinance changes, really having all of these groups here represented on working groups as we dive into the issues and decide what these changes should probably look like. And then, of course, the media, which we'll get into. So just real quickly on industry communication and outreach. I think one thing that's been really valuable for us is the regular check-ins. This wasn't something, again, with no template really of how to do this. I don't think anyone was quite sure the best way to communicate with the industry, and I'm not sure that we have figured that out yet. However, the sort of semi-formal nature of these check-in meetings with all the industry groups that we, you know, invite to come and bring another representative along with them have been really helpful for just, you know, keeping our finger on the pulse of what the issues are in the industry, and then, of course, vice versa, they can understand what it is we're thinking about and the challenges that we're faced with. Bulletins, which I'll show off, that website, which I mentioned earlier, all of these things, we just have really made the effort of trying to make it easier to find information. Even things that are relatively simple in concept, but extremely helpful in practice, documents and handouts for what the inspection process is going to look like, how the permitting process goes, things like that. So our industry bulletins, just a quick snapshot. You can see the long list of the ones that we've put out recently, and sort of an example of one there on the other side. But I think what's fun for me about this is, it's probably too small to see, but in that example, we put out a survey and said, hey, just tell us what you think. How's the licensing process going for you all? And getting that kind of feedback is really helpful. Of the many emails we've put out there, many about recalls and the pesticide issue, all those holds, obviously. But one in particular, or maybe two in here, about DPD, Denver Police Department district meetings. They decided that each district commander would have basically an open house at the district station and invite some industry folks to come in and talk about security issues in their neighborhood, what the cops are seeing there, and what sort of measures the businesses themselves could take to help protect themselves. Those, as you might expect, we got tremendous feedback on. People who missed it want to do it. We want to do more of those types of things. Really invaluable in terms of putting faces with names. Shockingly, industry folks and cops definitely don't communicate a whole lot and haven't in the past, but that type of a setup really helps with that. Other things we talked about, the security issues with burglaries. Although marijuana-related crime is less than 2% of crime in Denver, marijuana businesses are our most burglarized businesses. So, you know, more so than convenience stores, liquor stores, things like that. And a lot of this happens at the grow facilities, not necessarily the retail stores where cash is the target, but the actual product in the cultivation facilities has been targeted. And so allowing, you know, some information out about that is really important. Again, getting that sort of public safety message from the city to the businesses has been really helpful. Little things, licensing changes, all that kind of stuff, we try to keep the industry apprised of as they happen. So with all that said, you got to think about your timing with these messages. So like I mentioned, trust of the government doesn't exactly come naturally to the cannabis industry, and that's not a knock on the industry, but you know, there was definitely a feeling of, well, anyone in the government from the industry side was basically viewed as a narc before 2014. Anyone in the industry from the law enforcement side is basically viewed as a criminal. So that relationship, smoothing that over, will take lots of time. So I mentioned yesterday, March 13th of this year was the day we put out the initial bulletin on pesticides. And you know, all the fallout from that was us moving as quickly as possible and dealing with this new information that had come into the city that we have a public health risk. Never once did we think about the fact that it was March and that 420, also known as Christmas for the industry, was right around the corner. And I remember Ashley and I sitting in an industry meeting and hearing from them that they had thought we did it on purpose to sabotage their sales for 420. And it was like one of those eye-opening moments where I thought, wow, the trust here is, it's gonna take a long time to build up. And we're working on that every day. At the same time, when we were doing the industry meetings following that, you know, we heard from folks that we were dragging their name through the mud, that we were singling out their business because, you know, some fire inspector who had been in their facility inspecting them didn't like them personally. Things of that nature, where really, you know, I'm joking here about the conspiracy theories, but it did strike me a little bit as paranoid. And, you know, again, as the city, as a government, whatever level you're at, you have to remain an open book. And if some consumers group puts in a Freedom of Information request or a Colorado Open Records Act request of you, you have to turn over that information. It's not about you know, singling out businesses. It's just saying, yes, these are the ones, these are the 11 facilities that have plants on hold right now. To the extent that you can communicate that to those growers and allow them to know that this stuff is coming is definitely helpful. But again, my point with everything is just that the timing of these things don't always align well with business plans. So we attempted to lower the temperature of those heated discussions. And as I touched on briefly yesterday, you know, we went through six meetings with industry groups and their representatives, lobbyists, you know, people that were putting political pressure on the mayor's office to basically put a halt to any kind of, you know, stepping in on the health risk aspect of pesticides. The seminars that Marley participated in on a worker protection standard all started out very contentious, ended up with a lot of thank you, that was great information. And the picture here was the 200 plus attendees at a facilitated educational meeting that we held just to basically walk through what the process is. It included the panel that was there today, included people from the CDA, which was invaluable. Obviously the Colorado Department of Agriculture has a huge role to play in all of this. There was a entomologist from CSU who's an expert on pesticides who could just speak about some of the science. I mean, again, as we mentioned yesterday, we're not the experts on pesticides, so someone that could really speak to that was really important. And obviously there was multiple city representatives there. So jumping into some of the other aspects of external communications, this Know the Law, was, and I've got examples of this I'll hand out afterwards, but the Know the Law campaign was really just a way to educate people about what is and isn't legal in Denver. Codifying that rule in city ordinance is a specific one about not using in parks, so that can be cited against, and you've got that listed in all of our parks. The website for that, marijuanainfodenver.com, talks about all of this stuff. And it's really helpful, I think, as a resource for the general public that is looking for information, to the extent that you can build out answers to frequently asked questions, have your city attorneys review it when things are, you know, maybe go through on a regular basis and update as things change. If anything, this is helpful to me and your PIOs, people that are faced with these questions all the time. There's a lot of resources here that can be built out for your community and help that discussion. The Good to Know campaign, anyone who saw Aaron touch on that earlier, I'm gonna toggle over to that. Can you display that for me? So the Good to Know campaign was really invaluable for the city in particular because of the resources that were at their disposal to inform the campaign. And it's a lot of message testing, finding out what people want to know, how people feel about it. And I think what was interesting for me was, you know, Coloradans in particular felt like we were sort of had a microscope on us, that we were being made fun of, and all of a sudden, you know, late night talk shows and everybody is pointing the spotlight at Colorado, and people wanted to get to a campaign that was positive, but that let people know, you know, what you can and can't do here. So what they were able to do is a sort of positive message about being 21, not driving high, all the things that you would expect, but in a way that wasn't scolding anyone, that wasn't you know, trying to make fun of the fact that marijuana is now legal in Colorado, but just being informative and really positive there. So, I mean, what does this joke even mean, Jimmy? Come on. I guess stoners like McDonald's. I don't know. It was in all of the market research, I think we found a lot of sort of almost hurt feelings. Like, look, we're progressive. We're Colorado. We're gonna do this. We're gonna implement it the right way. You know, we're not just a punchline. I mean, we're the Mile High City, for crying out loud. It's too easy. Our city attorney's name is Marley. We just, you know, like, give us a break. So I guess all of this is to say that, as we've said many times over the last couple of days, that, you know, the story is still being written. And we, us here in Denver, around Colorado, from whichever community you represent, has an incredible opportunity to tell your own story. Look, I get to brag, really, is what my job is. You saw all of the presentations so far. There's an amazing amount of excellent work being done, and it's all targeted at making our city better and responding to the needs and desires of our community. And being able to brag about that work is where the story should be told. I'll also pass out our report that we did earlier this year called Retail Marijuana, the Denver Collaborative Approach. Now that, it was a small example of us trying to tell the story from the city's perspective and pointing out to folks all of the collaboration that is necessary to make this work, but also giving them, you know, the basic facts and figures on number of stores and crime and things like that, which are the questions, of course, we get asked about all the time. But again, I would just point out, it's not about the studies that are commissioned and done with an agenda in mind, trying to prove a specific point. There's lots of good research out there that doesn't have an agenda that is available to focus on. And it's that focus that we do, not advocating one way or another for or against marijuana. It's here, so we're gonna implement it in a way that our community needs it to, and that's really what the story is. So the Denver Post recently, as we touched on, wrote an editorial, and it said it would be foolish to look solely at the economic benefits generated from legally sold marijuana in Colorado and declare the entire undertaking an unqualified success. Now, I couldn't agree more, but what are they really asking or saying in that editorial? And it was really about, sure, the revenue is there. Marijuana is paying its own way. We've hired lots of staff to be able to help us manage this. But what are the social impacts going to be? And we don't know yet. Now, to me, I think it would also be foolish to limit it to just those two things, revenue and social impacts. There's a lot more that we can look at, such as marijuana-related crime versus incarcerations. These are the types of stories that will need to be told in your community, specifically responsive to those numbers. Now, in Denver, you know, it wasn't something that's been, marijuana has been decriminalized for quite some time. It's not something that we've been throwing large amounts of people in jail for quite a while now, but that may be different in other parts of the country, and that's a story that can be told. Again, removing a stigma of marijuana users and the industry and all those that are associated with that, but also balancing that with removing the perception of risk among children and people like that who now just say, well, it's legal, so everything's fine. Again, the story's still being written. I guess another way to look at that would be, we don't know yet. My wife is pretty sure Jon Snow's coming back. I think most of the ladies who watch the show are pretty sure he's coming back. But I think he might be dead. I don't know. That is just something that you have to be comfortable saying as a communications person, as a policymaker even, in this world, is that we don't have all the answers yet, and this is going to take time. Oh, geez. So there's lots of stories to be told. Whether you're talking about legacy media organizations like the New York Times or the Denver Post, broadcast news outlets all the time are calling international. I think there's a wave that will be coming from our neighbors to the north in Canada, Western Europe. Lots of Caribbean nations have reached out to us. Their media follows up on those visits and those questions come. Lifestyle and culture publications and websites are very interested in the marijuana space and want to know what's going on. Tech companies, I mean, again, you talk about easy pitches, you know, just the fact that our firefighters are going to be able to use tablets in their inspection processes made the news, because why not? Long-form documentaries, that is particularly challenging to manage those stories. You've got anyone who has a Natia lookalike in their organization become her best friend or his best friend, because that data is very, very much important to telling these stories. And again, having those people, whether it's from the fire department or the police department, whatever those organizations are within your community that can speak well about the day-to-day changes they're seeing and what the important issues are related to marijuana. And of course, I kid, but the dreaded local TV news who drops in, needs something from you in 5 seconds and wants to get something on TV in 5 minutes and then never call you again for any clarification or follow-up questions. But can't really blame them. This is a quote that I heard about 6 months into this job. If the word marijuana is in it, it'll be our most clicked story of the day, so we're going to cover everything you guys do. And that was another one of those moments for me where I figured, okay, I see how it's going to be. It's important, you know, people care about this stuff. It's not just, you know, me sitting at my desk saying, oh, this is such a drag, you know, I have so much other stuff to get done. It's really the fact that our community wants to know this. They're clicking on that story on that website every time the word marijuana is in it. So it would be silly of me not to respond to it. So speaking of coverage, I wanted to just quickly highlight some of the work that Ricardo's done. Frankly, I thought we were through the major wave of pesticide coverage. And I think on September 16th or 17th, I was feeling like it was pretty much done. Until Ricardo's colleague David Magoya called. And David is an investigative reporter with the Denver Post. And anyone who deals with the media knows that once it gets to the investigative level, it's a whole other ballgame. And so we have seen a series of stories on pesticide. And to me, what's been special about it is that the Post has made an investment in this issue. They have bought product and had paid for it to be tested. That testing served as a referral to our Department of Environmental Health to follow up, and subsequent recalls and holds that have been placed because of that have been reported on. So it's all part of this interconnected community we have between the government and the media. And it's been something to behold. So I'm not going to touch too much more on that. I'll let Rick talk about the Post and the process they follow and everything involved with that. But just to sort of introduce him a little bit, the Cannabist is a website, I guess a micro site of the Denver Post, you might say, and is been really amazing in the way it has covered the industry, the culture, everything that is happening with marijuana, both in Colorado and outside of it. Ricardo Baca is someone who knows Denver probably better than anyone I can think of. He really is this city personified. He's a former music critic with the Post and seems to know pretty much everyone in town. So I'll let him sort of take it away and talk about the website and the media in general.
All right. Is this thing on? Cool. Thanks, Dan. And thanks to all of you for coming out and having me here. And it's funny about that Anchorman meme over there earlier, because it's true. You know, I've worked for the Post for coming up on 14 years now, and I worked for the other daily newspaper here in Colorado for 4 years before that. And, you know, marijuana does mean interest, but it is worth noting that normalization is happening. Normalization is real, and no longer is that true for us, I would say. You know, it used to be back in the day, if pot, marijuana, if that's what it was about, it would have been one of the biggest stories of the day, but that's not necessarily so anymore. So it's just interesting how things are changing. But again, my name is Ricardo, and Ricardo Baca. I'm the marijuana editor at the Denver Post. I run The Cannabist. And it's thecannabist.co, and Dan and Ashley asked me if I would come up here and speak for 10 minutes and maybe have a bit of a conversation and take any questions, so I'm happy to do that, but just kind of wanted to give you the basics of how the Post landed at this strange place of actually hiring a marijuana editor, and that is, you know, when we voted, oddly, have you guys touched on this? 3 years ago today? Yeah, 3 years ago today, Colorado voted 55% to 45% to legalize Amendment 64, which legalized recreational marijuana. So, very interesting. And at that time, the editor of the Post, Greg Moore, decided that he wanted to cover marijuana like the legal substance that it was. A very straightforward approach that not only intensified our news coverage, but also amped up, or really started, the coverage of this as a culture. You know, it's legal now, we can talk about it as if it's legal. So let's start a standalone vertical, The Cannabist. We didn't know what it was going to be called or what it would look like when I was hired in November of 2013, but that's what he wanted to do. Let's name it, let's find the URL, let's hire a staff, and let's figure out how we're going to cover weed, basically. And it was controversial. Certainly, you know, the calls for canceled subscriptions on one side. On the other side, you have the activists saying, Ricardo, why is your title marijuana editor? It should be cannabis editor, because marijuana is an inherently racist term. And yeah, so that was a whole interesting thing that we went through. Bill O'Reilly certainly had his way with us. He's from Denver. He's a former Denver broadcaster, I think, with Channel 7. So yeah, I got a couple invites on his show and just politely declined because I knew the direction that was going. But he basically said the Post was trying to promote pot. And, you know, that's just simply not the case. As you can see from some of the stories that Dan showed you earlier. But basically, what we saw as our responsibility is that as journalists, here is a newly legal industry that didn't really have a lot of legitimate journalism associated with it. You know, High Times turns 41 years old this year, and that's amazing. And High Times is an important part of this conversation, but at the same time, High Times was started by a drug smuggler named Tom Frasad, who, you know, wanted to leave his legacy in the form of an activist-centered publication. And he has, and it's very successful. And they have added 20, 30 pages to the book in the last couple years, primarily because of recreational legalization. What we wanted to do is just move beyond that, start to approach marijuana from a journalistic point of view. Certainly talk about the good, the bad, to always talk to both sides of the story. But also, you know, this is legal for anyone 21 years and older in Colorado, as you all know. So, you know, why wouldn't we hire multiple pot critics to talk about this substance that we know almost nothing about? Why not hire these experts in the field who can actually talk about it, one of whom is in the back. Soham, raise your hand real quick. That's Soham Shah. He's one of our pot critics, and he's out here covering the event for us. But so that's kind of how the Post landed here. And we really just wanted to kind of talk about the new pot journalism. And what you're starting to see now is everybody's doing this now. Certainly before November of 2013, the Post was covering marijuana regularly, the crimes associated with it, the movements within our regulated medical system, and what was happening elsewhere. But this just gave us an opportunity. This was the center of the world for that time, and still is to an extent. And so we just wanted to make sure that we were covering it, and hopefully covering it responsibly. Dan also asked me a little bit to talk about, you know, how you hire a team of journalists to cover this beat, and also who is pitching you and that team of journalists. And you know, I was the music critic previously, and so I started a music blog that ended up having 20 or 30 or 40 contributors, writers and photographers. And so I had a little bit of history with that. I was also the paper's entertainment editor before this position. So hired a couple people and, you know, saw turnover that way. So this was a little bit different just because weed was not my world when I was first appointed the marijuana editor. So there was a very quick learning curve and going back and rereading the first chapter of Eric Schlosser's Reefer Madness, and you know, which is a fantastic chapter. If you've never read it, it's a must read. You know, but just really acquainting myself for the first time truly with this thing that I was now charged with covering and editing, this you know, shepherding this coverage for the newspaper. So I definitely reached out to a couple close friends who I had, who either had a lot of experience with marijuana or actually worked in the local cannabis industry, and from there expanded, met more people, and I think we've developed a pretty special and important team of journalists, writers, critics, thinkers, who write regularly for The Cannabist, and now their work is starting to appear in the Denver Post itself, so that's exciting as well. I did want to touch on, because I know that there has been a lot of criticism of the site. You know, when you go to a website like this and you see, well, there's Colorado News, that's great, there's US News, there's culture, there's reviews, you know, what, these people are reviewing vape pens in a major metropolitan daily newspaper. But you know, it's an important part of that conversation. I mean, me and my colleague John Ingold, who's done some of the most important marijuana journalism around, we were just talking yesterday about some of the vape pens, you know, and so in these legal markets, you have companies selling preloaded vape cartridges just like e-cigarettes, and they're all over the US. And what happens is you have THC oil, but it's too, at least what I'm told, it's too thick to really vaporize, and so it needs to be mixed with a mixing agent. And there's a bunch of different mixing agents out there. There's something called, I have polypropylene glycol or something, which is popular, is that right? And then there's coconut oil, and you know, the propylene glycol people don't like the coconut oil people and say that coconut oil shouldn't be inhaled, and the coconut oil people say, well, we do this because this is the proper alternative to polypropylene glycol, which you know, it's a very big conversation, and that story alone that me and Ingold were talking about kind of illustrates the great challenge of this beat. And that is the unknown, you know. Whether we're writing about the mixing agent in a vaporizer pen, or we're talking about pesticides, we don't know. You know, the regulators saying that these are potentially unsafe chemicals being used on plants, it's important to say that in the reporting and in on the city side too, because we just don't know. The studies haven't been done. We're talking with the EPA in the pesticide reporting that my colleague David Magoya and I have been doing for honestly the last 4 or 5 months. Talked with the EPA and also these chemical companies, Dow, and in order to get, you know, your product listed on the label of a pesticide, which is governed by the EPA, it takes millions of dollars and years of studies. And so cannabis is becoming newly legal, and how long is it going to take for that specific crop to have pesticides that are specific to it actually labeled on the label? It's going to be a very long time. There's so much that we don't know, but what you're seeing here all throughout this entire symposium is that the city is just, and the state is approaching this from a, you know, from a point of being cautious and aware, because I mean, what else can you do? You know, here we have all, we're selling hundreds of thousands of vape pens all across this country, and we have these different mixing agents, and truth be told, we don't know a lot about all of them. It's worth saying that propylene glycol is very popular in inhalers and stuff, but still, what happens when you're using Eagle 20 pesticide on a cannabis plant and it has mycobutanol, and then it's combusted? You know, it's the plant is grown and then harvested and cured, and then you're putting it to fire, or you're you're making it into a THC extract with a super high, you know, a process that involves butane or propane or CO2. And we just don't know what that means when microbutanol is combusted and then inhaled. Because true, it is legal on certain crops. And we eat those crops after it's deteriorated a little bit, but there's just so much that we don't know. Who is pitching us regularly? You know, occasionally we get pitches from the city, and those are always good conversations. But as you might imagine, this industry is blowing up, and I didn't think it was possible to get more emails in my inbox than when I was a music critic, because then you have, you know, not only every major label, but every indie label and every local band and all of the self-starters who are just reaching out to you, who want coverage for their Denver show or their new album. But wow, I think weed passed that up very quickly. And now you have this industry of self-starters, of big corporations, of mom and pops, and regulators and watchdogs who want your eye and want your attention. And it's really, it's honestly impossible to wade through that. I've certainly missed many emails where I'm like, oh, I did get that email and I didn't realize that that study was legit, because you hear about how many new marijuana studies every month and how many of those actually are legit in terms of having the right number of participants, or was it, you know, triple blind, or was it done under the university infrastructure? And so it really is hard to get the attention of the people covering the legitimate cannabis media because of all of that noise, but it's also very, very possible if you have a good story. And, you know, it's worth saying that this pesticide story is a great story. It's not good that it's happening in general, but I mean, it happened and now we're moving past it, and that's ultimately a good thing. And I'll even be the first to acknowledge the Post was late to the story. Dan recognized that he thought it was largely over by the time that we called the city agencies and just started talking about the fact that we were going to start stepping into this and we were doing our own testing. Which is something that we had already done a couple of different times, because last year I do ingest marijuana, and you know, one of the things that I noticed in those early days is that edibles were incredibly inconsistent. This is one story that's worth just mentioning and break out. My first legal purchase recreationally was January 2014 at a small shop in Empire, Colorado, which is in the Rockies. And I was going to a friend's cabin for the weekend, and my friends were vaporizing. I had a 10 milligram edible, which was normally more than enough, and yet I felt nothing. 2 hours later, I felt nothing. And here I am, you know, the writer who is trying to educate people about responsible consumption. And I'm like, 2 hours is enough. I should have felt something, and so I took another. And then nothing, seriously. And so I think that ultimately I ingested 20, what was supposed to be 25 milligrams of activated THC that night, and felt absolutely nothing. And I took that package of edibles made by a local MIP, a maker of infused product, called Dr. J's, and I just put them in the refrigerator because I knew there was a story there. I just didn't know when or what it was going to look like. And a couple months later, I got a call from a shop saying she had more than 400 customers return product from a single maker of edibles, and I was not surprised to hear that it was Dr. J's. And that ended up being a big story last March, where we bought 10 different edible brands. We took them into a lab and had them tested for THC content. So if they label 100 milligrams of activated THC on the label, what does that actually look like when you put it through the science, when you put it through the lab process, and with the Dr. J's products, which we tested four of, they had as little as 0.3 milligrams of THC in a product that was supposed to have 100. So that's 1/500th of what they were supposed to have. They were full on ripping off their customers. And it's important to talk about that. So with the pesticide story, we recognized that we were late to it. I didn't recognize the importance of it when it first broke. We did write about it, but then we just kind of like let it settle. And when we decided to jump back in, we're like, let's do some testing. And that's kind of how we found ourselves here. So it's been it's been a total treat to be a journalist and to be able to write on this emerging industry, and I'm incredibly passionate about it. And if any of you all have any questions that you'd like to ask now or drop me an email later, please do. I'll just throw this out there real quick. My Twitter is Bruvs, B-R-U-V-S, and my email is rbaca, R-B-A-C-A, at denverpost.com. So.
Do we have any questions for Ricardo or myself? Can you use the mic, or I'm sorry, there's a mic stand up there. We're recording it, so.
Hi, I'm Kara Laveau from Denver Environmental Health, and I have a question for Ricardo. I'm just curious. I'm the one that deals with all the pesticide issues for the city, and I'm curious if you've had like a backlash from industry. You know, I hear that they were quite upset with the articles that you've written and kind of ratting them out, so to speak. So I was kind of curious if you've dealt with any industry backlash.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, I think, you know, activists on both sides of the legalization issue have had many issues with us since we started doing this about 2 years ago. They think we do this wrong. They think we do this wrong. And generally, when you're a journalist, if both sides of the issue that you're covering are kind of like have those gripes, then generally you know that you're doing your job right because you're trying to stay somewhere there. Talk to them, talk about what needs to be happening. But going back to the edibles potency story, I mean, they certainly felt like it was a witch hunt. The industry expected us to give them a tip that we were going to start testing their edibles, when of course you would never do that in an independent test, and if you're a journalist, you would never tip an industry off if you're about to do that. That would be, it goes against the entire idea of it. With pesticides, there's certainly been some of that. And as you know, Kara, this is such a complex and heated issue that, we've had people in the industry call us out and say that we're the City of Denver's cheerleaders, Colorado Department of Agriculture's cheerleaders. That's just simply not the case. We just had a conversation one day inside the newsroom and said, I wonder what would happen if you tested some of these products for pesticides. These holds, original holds, happened, as Dan mentioned, in March. Conversations around those holds started happening in February, which we didn't know at the time, but here, you know, a couple months later, are these products still being sold to consumers in Colorado? And that was a great germination point for a story that we didn't really know was going to be a story, because we could have easily gone out and purchased those concentrates and taken them to the lab that is testing for pesticides, and there might have been nothing in them. And sure enough, I think we tested 5 or 6 brands of marijuana concentrates, and only one brand had these banned pesticides in them. The other 4 or 5 brands were super clean. So there was almost, that would have been a story that, whatever, 4 or 5 months after the original hold, there were no banned pesticides in these products. But it wouldn't have been as big of a story as it's become, as long of a story as it's become. So yeah, certainly there has been that backlash, and I'm still in contact with a gentleman named Tom Sterlachy, who is the owner of Dr. J's Edibles, and I keep trying to get him on my talk show. And Danica, too. Danica, you're coming on my talk show sometime. But I recommend you check it out. It's on the website. We put it up every Friday, and I still want Tom to come on and talk about that process, because here he was a business owner. And according to him, he believes that he was putting out a product that was good, and then he realized that he was putting out a product that was totally bunk. And whether he knew it or didn't know it, that's something that I just am not aware of. But you know, it's been a fascinating journey. So.
We talk quite a lot about transparency of information. Yet I've been relatively surprised by how little information is available, for example, from the MED in terms of the nature and composition of sales and what's growing and what's not growing. You hear a little bit about edibles, for example. Have you got a lot of demand in the media for more detailed information like that? And if so, who's satisfying it?
Yeah, you know, that's interesting too, because when Washington rolled out its system last July, It didn't take us long to recognize that the state of Washington was keeping its data in a very different way than the state of Colorado. Every month, the Department of Revenue, which is where the MED resides, releases tax data on recreational and marijuana sales. And so that's kind of an indicator. You know, as a journalist, we love data. We love to compile that data and to look at it on a larger view, to kind of view trends. What happens? Or are we really selling more cannabis in Colorado during those tourism seasons? And we are. We're starting to see that now that we have a couple years of data. But the state of Washington releases its data store by store. And that is so fascinating, because then you can look at it and say, oh, wow, yeah, so this, here's the top five biggest selling stores in Washington last month. And I think that's really valuable. We just, as far as I know, we just don't have that, and it wasn't set up to be that way. So there's always hunger for more information. And I think that's definitely the biggest and most frustrating part of this conversation. When we were in, it's just starting off, January, February 14, there was nothing. There was nothing to be had. Our readers wanted concrete information. We had anecdotal. We had, you know, even very intelligent, in the thick of it, people talking about what they were experiencing, but no concrete information. We're starting to see that now. It's worth noting now, just especially because we were just talking about those testing stories, because of Colorado law, you know, most of the people in this room and I as a journalist cannot test marijuana in a state licensed lab. And that's one of the most frustrating pieces of this entire situation. My colleague Noelle Crombie at the Oregonian, who does great work in Portland, talking with her, she was getting ready her pesticide testing story not too long ago. And yeah, anybody off the street can walk into a cannabis testing facility in Oregon and drop off a bag. And maybe it was something they bought in a store, maybe it was something they grew at home, maybe it was something they bought off the street. Colorado, you can't do that. You need to be you need to have a marijuana license to test it. And so what's happened with our most two recent testing stories is we've had to work with dispensaries that we can buy the product from, and then they transfer that product to a testing facility via their license. And it's hard, and it's also incomplete, because our story could only test concentrates for pesticides, because concentrates are one of the easier things to purchase from a store, and that store wasn't necessarily responsible for that content. And so they feel comfortable allowing you to transfer it to the lab to test it. But if that store is growing its own pot, they're not going to want to transfer their pot to a testing facility to see what's in there unless they've already tested it, and it takes away from the independent nature of what we need to do as journalists. So I think that's, you know, another point where we just don't have access to the data and the information that we'd like as journalists. So.
Well, I think actually we do have the data, we just don't make it available yet.
That argument could be made.
And, you know, from the government side, we spent a lot of time not only collecting the data, but just thinking about which data is most important. I obviously get a lot of questions about number of stores and things like that, so we spent I guess a year now building out a dashboard of data that will help our decision makers. And Natia is going to touch on this in her session after lunch on data collection. But just a little plug, part of that will be publicly facing later on this year. And not only will it sort of just allow for an open data for people to start using in their studies and answer a lot of questions up front, it'll help us track those trends. It'll help me better understand what other data points are missing from that we can maybe add to it in the future.
And I'll just add a little bit more, because, you know, we are hungry for this information. And here we have Visit Denver, which handles tourism inside the city, and we have the Colorado Department of Tourism, or whatever it's called. But we do want this information about what marijuana is bringing to Colorado, if anything. I'm not assuming that it's bringing anything. We see lots of out-of-state people at 420 around that weekend. Certainly the shops provide a lot of anecdotal information about, oh, we see 50% out-of-state driver's licenses. We see 80% out-of-state driver's licenses. And yet here we are, 3 years after voting, almost 2 years after implementing, and we have next to no data on what tourism has been brought to Colorado, if any, by the legalization of cannabis, and that's frustrating. I would love a more open line of communication, and we've certainly attempted it, and we just keep getting the same line that marijuana is not contributing tourism to the city of Denver, and that's generally what we get, and that's hard because that's not enough. So I hope that some talks that we're in right now with some of these organizations about maybe opening their books on hotel occupancy, on some of these big weekends, 420 weekend, and just trying to see if there are any trends there that can tell us, yes, this has meant an uptick for tourism in Denver or Colorado, or no, it's exactly the same as it was, and any other growth is a result of the Broncos or skiing and snowboarding or whatever else it might be. So, you know, there's a long way to go.
Hi guys, Jordan Wellington. I had two different questions, one for each of you. So my question for Dan, and I think this is one of the really interesting aspects in communications, is there's so many different departments within the city government that are engaging in communication with the public around cannabis issues, from law enforcement to excise and licensing, communications with the industry, communications. And I was wondering if you could just talk about kind of the overall job of managing not just the fact that you need to be communicating, but you've got these kinds of lines of information coming up from all these different sources and how you've been able to kind of manage and organize that. And then for Ricardo, I'd love to hear more about if you guys plan to do anything about the issue around testing, right? Because as you've said, the only people that can test are within the industry, and this creates kind of a dearth of information in the public sphere about what's contained in products and potency, and it would seem like that would be an issue that the Denver Post might be able to engage on to try to gain some kind of change in that policy, because I think there's, well, quite frankly, it would be good if that got changed. So, that's it.
Thanks, Jordan. Yeah, for my piece, you know, there's a couple aspects to that. One, the media part and managing all of the departments that get questions about it has been fairly easy, partially because we have a lot of really great communications people in the city who are happy to leave that story on my plate and focus on their own issues, because we're all extremely busy and getting questions all over the place. But I think part of it too is that I've sort of positioned myself and volunteered myself to be that person that's going to be the gopher and go digging for the information. So it's really just a relationship aspect in terms of managing the media stories. Now, there's also the internal communications, and then there's communications that happen on sort of an inspector to business owner level and those types of things. And that's obviously much harder because I'm not inspecting those buildings and I'm not getting those questions. So again, data is a big point of it. We track the questions that we get via email and via 311 and try to identify, okay, what are people consistently asking for and asking us about? And then we put those on the website via FAQs. We communicate them back to the inspectors, to the people who are dealing with citizens or business owners on a day-to-day level. And that's really how we've managed it. From a communications aspect to the businesses, and then internally, really, it's Ashley and Molly and everyone in our team doing a great job of basically saying, here's what's coming next, and here are some of the issues we're facing, and it's really just my job to sort of be the go-between and try to get everyone involved in those discussions. And then if there's going to be changes made, obviously roll out with that.
And yeah, so is the Post planning on doing anything on testing? without giving away some of our coverage that we're planning over the next couple months, last year we did a big year-end, one-year-end kind of project, and we'll be doing something along the same lines this year. I think it's important, but it's also one of those aspects of this industry that we as journalists can't get too tied up into. I can say personally, I really wish that we had more open access to testing as a journalist. I want to be able to test for pesticides all of the products that are out there and all of them that are available. And instead, we have to work within this very narrow loophole that allows us to conduct a test that's independent enough for us to feel comfortable with it. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if you'll see something in the paper in the next couple months.
Hi, John from Australia here. Interested whether your audience reaches other countries as part of what you're actually trying to create, and with Australia looking to sell its first medical marijuana product in 2016, do you think that's a story that's interesting to the Post as well as the broader audience?
Yes. Yeah. So we, you know, the metrics and analytics available in the modern web technology is amazing. So we know exactly who's reading us at all hours of the day. And Australia is decent. It's a decent audience. For some reason, Scandinavia is huge. Texas is massive. Texans are very curious about what's happening in legal marijuana, and they've taken a liking to the cannabis, thankfully. So, and certainly, you know, an anecdote from earlier this week that might give you a little bit of insight to what people come to us for. You know, clearly we're based in Denver. Most of our writers are based in Colorado. We do have writers in other legal and illegal states, but the majority of our work is here. At the same time, I said earlier, this is ground zero, but you know, it was a big election earlier this week. Ohio voted on recreational and medical legalization, a very controversial amendment that involved what many have called a monopoly on the growing side. So 10 corporations would have been in charge of growing, and then there were other possibilities for people opening shops. And it failed, and many have made the point that perhaps that ballot initiative wasn't about legalization, and it was more about greed or monopolization. But We have been hammering Ohio for weeks. You know, any AP or Washington Post, these are the primary wires that we subscribe to. Any content about Ohio, any content that we could self-generate, you just can't do enough as a municipality, as a location is coming up on either the vote or the implementation. So certainly it. And it shows, you know, our traffic this week is spectacular because of not only Ohio, but the election in general. We had some important questions here in Colorado about, you know, the world's first pot-funded scholarship down out of Pueblo, Colorado, and Proposition BB up here. But, you know, so certainly that's something that we will definitely be covering, and we have covered already, and that we will continue to cover. And if you know any good freelancers, tip them my way for sure.
Christopher Mallory, Boulder County Marijuana Licensing. This is actually for you, Ricardo. We were talking a little bit earlier, but everyone keeps talking about all the tax dollars that are coming in. And yes, there is tax money coming in. But have you guys looked into it all? At least I've seen it from my perspective, taking in all the fees and stuff. Everyone wants, you know, how much are you guys taking in for this and that? But really what's more important, I think, for Colorado is all the other ancillary businesses that surround the industry. So you got money going to contractors, the plumbers, the electricians. You got all the different type of green businesses that are coming out, whether they're making the packaging or the lights. There's so much of that going on. I think that's actually more important than necessarily the money that's coming in from the industry, because eventually the licensing fees, it'll just support the government that controls it. The more important part, I think, is what's coming in from all the outside businesses that are surrounding it. I mean, you live here, you know how rent's gone up. Is that part of it too? I mean, have you guys looked into any of that kind of thing that's going on?
You know, that's important stuff. Unfortunately, we're in the middle of, like, everybody here knows the downsizing of mainstream media, and so we have fewer staff writers than we did last year, than we did the previous year. So oftentimes what we rely upon is the legitimate market research companies out there doing that kind of research. And I don't know that any really solid, rock solid reporting has been done on that yet, but I do know that there's one paper being developed right now, and we're in touch with the authors, and I think that is hoping to bring together, you know, not only what the marijuana sales mean, but also what you know, the ancillary corporate dealings mean as well. Because, you know, if anybody's been paying attention to the amount of money, the amount of marijuana that has been sold this year, It's fascinating because it looks like we're going to top $900 million in sales, and that's strictly recreational and medical. And of course, as a journalist, that's fascinating because if you get to that billion-dollar number, then you have a billion-dollar industry. But then you have to look at the ancillary business being done around this sphere, and that's something that we're planning on doing with hopefully the release of this new research and this new paper soon, because certainly marijuana is bigger than $1 billion already in this state, and we know it, just not, you know, marijuana specifically. And touching on that too, I think it's also our part of our job to recognize that, you know, a lot of these numbers sound very big. $900 million in sales, it sounds massive. You know, one of the selling points on Amendment 64 was that the first $40 million of a certain tax would go towards schools. And $40 million in schools, voters like that, it sounds generally good. You know, but we also, as journalists, try and put that in perspective. And I had a state senator, Pat Stedman, on my talk show a couple months ago, and he helped put it in perspective. He said that, yeah, you know, 40 million, that's maybe one really great middle school with athletic fields or two really solid elementary schools, but what they're not building a single school. They're spreading that money throughout the entire state and saying this one needs a new air conditioning system and we need to repave this track over here on the eastern slope, and so putting these numbers into context, I feel, is my job. And I think that's also important, so we don't get swept away in $40 million for school, you know, weed is salvation, or whatever it might be. It's definitely good money, but it's not what a lot of people envision it as.
Got time for about one more question. Anyone want to get in there? I guess I'll ask real quick then, Rick. Is Colorado still a novelty, and what's your assessment of the current state of media coverage of Denver and Colorado, and where do you think we're headed next with it?
So I don't think Colorado's a novelty anymore, clearly. I mean, we were, and we launched, you know, thanks to the work of a lot of people in this room, this system launched 5-6 months before Washington, even though we voted on the same day. I think we're becoming less unique, and that's inevitable, especially given the direction public sentiment has turned. What was the second part of the question?
Just what's your assessment?
Oh, yeah. You know, for the most part, I think the journalism surrounding this issue in this state is fairly solid, but some of these matters are so intensely complicated. When you're talking about pesticides, when you're talking about something called Tabor, which many of you are familiar with, it's our taxpayers' Bill of Rights, it's really complicated. And so when you have a High Times freelancer trying to interpret something that was written by our legislative writer and completely misunderstanding it and throwing something out there that says that Colorado made so much money in the sale of weed in 2014 that now there's this abundance and we have to give it back, when that's not the case of Proposition BB and what we all just voted on. You know, I think there's a lot of misinformation out there. And again, look at activist-rooted media. Whether you're on one side of the equation with Project Sam as a national anti-legalization outfit, or your High Times, you know, it behooves you to present information in such a way that backs up your agenda. So it's not surprising that High Times would throw out a story that isn't accurate at all. So that can be frustrating, because then that gets picked up by so many other outlets, and then people have this idea that, you know, Colorado is swimming in weed tax money, and that's just simply not the case. So, but I'll hand the mic back to Dan. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Just a quick announcement, please grab lunch, but Yvette Van Groningen from the City of Amsterdam is going to do a little more informal presentation in here during lunch, so come on back for that if you'd like.